Heavenly Father, I pray that Pastor Mike's, his message comes straight from you, God, and it touches us and gives us the power and the strength to go out in our community and make a difference. In your holy name, amen. Amen.
If you keep it on, you can amen really loud from the chairs. Well, good morning. Couple quick housekeeping notes. We do have a board meeting coming up on Thursday, so we will be looking at some different proposals for some improvements to the driveway side, not an entire parking lot project, but the driveway side. Thankful to Vic for making it a little less, you can hear it when your shocks are gone. I didn't know if I was getting SOS, and I was trying to interpret it, and it was at a yeah, so thank you for smoothing that out, but we will be talking about some potential changes during the board meeting to that, so if you're interested in participating in that discussion, we invite you. And secondly, just I thank you for your candidness in sharing difficult things with the body of Christ to all of us during our praises and prayer times. One, it shows vulnerability on your part that the body of Christ, one, it should be doing what we're doing, which is you should feel safe in sharing some of those things with us, knowing that we're not going to gossip about them, but to trusting that we are going to bring those things before the Lord for you. So I know sometimes we hear some really heavy things in that, and I want to encourage that because we don't want to carry those burdens alone. So I'm not trying to pick on Vic again, but thank you for trusting us with what is definitely a very difficult thing in your life. And you're right, you're part of our family, Vic, and we love you and we're glad you're here with us. So thank you for trusting us with that. And to all of you who share those things with us, please know that they become part of our prayer life in the body of Christ as we knit our lives together as the body of Christ, seeking to bring him all the praise and all the glory. And please follow through on that. Bring those prayer requests to the Lord and trust in him for his provision for those things. And in reality, that really leads in so well to what we're looking at in this letter of Philippians. So if you have your Bibles with you, please have them open to Philippians chapter 2. That's where we're going to spend really most of our time this morning. I know that we've been bopping around a lot, and we'll bop around a little bit, but we're going to be honed in right on the verses 12 through 18 of chapter 2 of the book of Philippians. But those verses 12 through 18 don't mean a whole lot. They don't mean as much unless we hold them in their context is what I'm trying to say. So, boy, when I go to put this video online, I'll be editing that out. That don't mean a whole lot. I didn't mean that. So we have to hold these verses in their context. And 12 through 18 come after the glorious Christ hymn that we looked at last week. And just as a way of brief reminder, we looked at that parabolic description of Christ's humiliation coming from great exaltation, that he is God of all, God of very God. He's equal with God. And yet in his condescension, he condescended to earth in his humility. He came to earth. He took on flesh. And his descent to earth met its bottom apex in the death that he suffered on behalf of those who would place their trust in Jesus Christ. So you have this, in reality, a chosen fall from exaltation to condescension in humility and humanity, becoming fully God and fully man, and then we see that meteoric rise back to his glory heights that we view at as a mountain unobscured by clouds. We look at and we see the glory of Jesus Christ as he is now exalted back to the right hand of God and given the name above all names, the name at which every knee will bow. And it is on that, the heels of that beautiful, what many call a Christ hymn, that we find this next teaching. And so we take that into consideration as we read, but we're even given a beautiful textual reminder by Paul that that's the case, because he begins verse 12 with therefore. And we'll look at what that therefore is there for as we peel into this text. As many of you, if you've studied the Bible for long, you've heard that. If you ever come across the therefore, what's it there for? And usually they post and point backwards. So join us as we read, as Yvonne reads from Philippians 2, 12 through 18.
Reading in Philippians chapter 2, verses 12 through 18. Therefore, my dear friends, as you have always obeyed, not only in my presence, but now much more in my absence, continue to work out of your salvation with fear and trembling, for it is God who works in you to will and to act according to his good purpose. Do everything without complaining or arguing, so that you may become blameless and pure, children of God, without fault, in a crooked and depraved generation, in which you shine like stars in the universe, as you hold out the word of life, in order that I may boast on the day of Christ that I did not run or labor for nothing. But even if I am being poured out like a drink offering on the sacrifice and service coming from your faith, I am glad and rejoice with all of you. So you too should be glad and rejoice with me.
Stan made an appearance in that video too. He was all the way in the kitchen. This is the word of the Lord. Gracious God, I thank you for a willing body of Christ that's willing to read your word and to share your word with others. And Father, as we chew on this passage from your glorious letter to this Philippian church, God, may we glean some of these truths. May we be encouraged to hold fast to the word of life, and may we seek to shine as lights to this world that is around us. God, you've given us a great and glorious Savior. You've given us God, a very God, second member of the Trinity, to come to earth, to take on flesh, and to die for us. No greater thought can be conceived in a human mind, Lord, and even with our human minds, we fail to fully encompass what is captured in that dreadful yet beautiful sacrifice. God, on that stands our hope, because Christ didn't stay in the grave. He rose from the tomb, thereby securing our resurrection. And God, we wait now for him to come back again and to make all things new. Oh, for that glorious day. God, we love you, and may this rest of this time here this morning be pleasing to you and be a blessing to us as we exalt the name of Christ and seek to be honoring you and in a heart worshiping you from spirit and truth. And it's in your Son's amazing name we pray. Amen. So thank you, Yvonne, for doing that. I appreciate that. This is, like I said, coming on the heels of a beautiful description, poetic and yet real description of what Christ has done for us, becoming obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross. And the section that Yvonne just read for us begins with that therefore. And so like we just said, we always need to, whenever we come across that therefore, especially if we're just picking up, if you were just to think, like, I'm going to pick up the middle of Philippians chapter 2, and you read it, therefore, go back. Because that's Paul's way of saying there's more being built on here. You don't want to build the second floor and have the first floor missing, because unless you're without gravity, that's just not going to work. So we look backwards, and what this therefore is pointing back to in reality is 9 and 10, which says that God has highly exalted Jesus, him, and bestowed on him the name that is above every name, so that at the name of Jesus, every knee should bow in heaven and on earth and under the earth. And it includes 11, because every tongue will then confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. So that therefore in 12 is pointing that to, back to that. But if you're reading your Bibles, you'll notice that verse 9 also began with a therefore. So this is like, we got to take two steps back. What's the therefore? Therefore in 9 that we're building, that Paul is building his case on. Because 9 lets us know that Jesus Christ is exalted. He's back. He's back into that position of at the full right hand of God. And he has the glory that he had before he was then shielded in humanity. He's back to that highly exalted position. So what is that 9 pointing back to? And that 9, therefore, verse 9, therefore, points us back to verses 5 and 8, which is in reality a command to us. Paul's telling that Philippian church, which is in reality a very obedient church, they're doing a lot right. They're not perfect. We know that because there's correction to come. But Paul tells this church, have this mind, verse 5 of chapter 2, have this mind among yourselves, which is yours in Christ Jesus, which is yours. Have this mind, because you have it. Have this mind, which is yours in Christ Jesus, who though he was in the form of God, did not count equality with God a thing to be grasped, but emptied himself by taking the form of a servant and being born in the likeness of men and being found in human form, he humbled himself by becoming obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross. So that is the setup for what he's going to do in verse 12. Paul encouraging those Philippian believers to have the mind of Christ. He doesn't say have the mind of Confucius. Have the mind for us today of some celebrity, of People magazine, or some headline story of the news. He's saying have the mind of Christ. And the mind of Christ is humility. It's sacrificial unity. It's willing to give of ourselves. It's willing to give of ourselves sacrificially to others for the sake of unity. Because what did Christ do? He, being God, actually took on the form of man. Became fully human as a form of a servant. Highly exalted, took on the form of a servant. Which is actually a reminder in Paul's beautiful logic as he builds this case of verses 2 and 3 of this first, or of the first part of chapter 2. Complete my joy, he says, by being of the same mind. Being unified. What's that same mind? Jesus Christ, he told us in 5. Be of the same mind, have the same love, be in full accord, unity with one another. Do nothing from selfish ambition or conceit. No wiggle room. Do nothing from selfish ambition or conceit. Be like Christ. Count others as more significant than yourselves and look not only to your own self-interests, have self-interests, of course, but also to the interests of others. The way Paul builds this argument is beautiful. He started with chapter 2 with the command, be unified, have this mind among yourselves, be self-sacrificial, give of yourself to the point of considering others more significant than yourselves. Then in 5 he starts telling us, what's that model based upon? Jesus, who though he was exalted and God, a very God, took on the form of humanity, took on human flesh and was fully God and fully man and was obedient to the point of death. But now he's exalted again. Therefore, verse 12, now that we understand the logic here, the call to be unified, to be self-sacrificial, to be considering others more highly than ourselves, why? Because it's Jesus Christ, and Jesus Christ did that, but is now exalted, which is a wonderful promise. Therefore, my beloved, as you have always obeyed. Boy, that's a wonderful thing for Paul to write. There are many churches around that he could write that to. Read Galatians. Read 1 Corinthians. There's not a whole lot of as you've always obeyed going on in those letters. This is a joy for Paul to write this letter. As you have always obeyed, so now, not only in my presence, but much more in my absence, work out your own salvation with fear and trembling. It's beautiful obedience that he is commending and recognizing is present in that body. But if we were honest here, some of us might hit that work out your own salvation and go, what in the world is going on there? Because we're saved by grace, right? We had to talk about this yesterday. Melanie's going to go, I've heard this already. Pastor, you nailed us with this yesterday at the funeral. We're saved by grace. Work out your own salvation. If last week's text was a hotbed for heresy, oh, you could be a God too. It says here that Jesus Christ was no longer God. He was only God because he was inspired of the Holy Spirit. So you're a little G God. If last week's text was a hotbed for bad teaching, people can abuse this verse too. And so one of the best ways to understand a phrase by an author for Paul, an inspired author, is to look at how else he has used that word. We can go to dictionaries, and those are obviously very important, but I love to start with looking at how does Paul use the phrase work out, which is in reality one word in the original language. So how does Paul use this? In Romans 4:15, he says, for the law brings wrath, but where there is no law, there is no transgression. And here that word brings, in Romans 4:15, the law brings wrath, is the same word. In essence, Paul is saying, trying to gain salvation by the law actually brings about or works out or produces wrath. Meaning, you can't work for your salvation. Yes, we are obedient, because he just said, you're obedient. Philippians, you're very obedient, as you've always obeyed. So he's not saying, don't obey. He's also not saying, we're earning our salvation. And that makes clear when we look at how he uses that same word in Romans 4:15. The law brings wrath or works out wrath or produces wrath. So for Paul, this idea is doing something that brings about a response. You want to work? You want to obey the law? It won't work. The law only works out in wrath. We have action or a chosen path, work out, and its necessary result. Just one chapter later in Romans 5, verse 3, Paul says, more than that, this is similar to our texts here in Philippians, more than that, we rejoice in our sufferings, knowing that suffering produces endurance. Suffering produces endurance. Suffering works out. Suffering produces endurance. Same word there. Kind of makes you wonder how in the world the prosperity gospel ever gets a footing when we read the Bible. Suffering produces endurance. When your health is bad, when you are persecuted, when you go through times of trials, when things are difficult, suffering produces endurance so that you can be obedient to God for His glory and His glory alone. So in that Romans 5 verse 3, that verse is housed in a paragraph that teaches we only have peace with God through faith. Paul says to rejoice in our sufferings because suffering produces or brings about or works out endurance. Two chapters later, Paul says this about sin in Romans, but sin, seizing an opportunity through the commandment, produced in me all kinds of covetousness. I can't be saved by the law. The law actually produced, worked out, brought about covetousness. I was aware that covetousness was a sin. Now all of a sudden, I see it everywhere. I'm seeing it in my life. I got to fight that sin of covetousness. And what Paul says here is the knowledge of sin, the law, which gives us knowledge of sin, actually allows us to be aware of it more. It produces, it brings about, it works out in covetousness. And one final example, just to move books, but same author, Paul writing in 2 Corinthians 4:17, says this, for this light momentary affliction, remember Paul's level of affliction? Light and momentary. He was eternity minded. For this light momentary affliction is preparing for us an eternal weight of glory beyond all comparison. Affliction preparing for us, working out, bringing about an eternal weight of glory beyond all comparison. Suffering stinks, but it has its purposes. We want all things to work out for good, as the Bible tells us, but then as one of our astute Sunday school colleagues says, good doesn't always mean easy. Thank you, Elaine, for that. I hope to keep that in my mind forever. So you have here this idea of working out means you have an action, a path, and then you have a result, and there are more examples, but I think we get the idea here looking at how Paul uses this term that we have in two words in the English language, work out your own salvation. Remember what Paul is saying in verses 2 through 5 of Philippians 2. Saying to them, keep on obeying. You're doing well. You're obedient. You're not perfect. Correction is coming. It's coming in this letter. But you're on the right path. And as you've always obeyed, Philippians continue to bring about, to work, to produce that glorious salvation to which you've been called. And that word salvation there is exactly that. That is salvation. That is the fact that you have been saved. And Paul's writing to the church. This is a plural call to work out. This isn't to an individual. This is to the church. Work out your salvation. Because he's called us to be unified, to be of one accord, to be of one mind, to have one love, to be self-sacrificial, to consider others more significant than we do ourselves, to be like Christ, to be Christ ones, to roll in Sunday school lesson. To be like those in Antioch. They're so Christ-minded that they're little Christs almost, to avoid heresy though. They're so Christ-like, they are identified with Christ. He's so ever on their mind. They emulate him. They seek to be like him as a body of diverse people coming from many backgrounds. But Pastor, this kind of still sounds like heresy to me. Work out your salvation. How in the world have I ever even caused my own salvation, let alone working it out? Because Jesus is the door to salvation. I didn't barge in. He opened it in. He welcomed me in. He called me as that lost sheep when I heard his voice. But dear friends, rest your discerning hearts in verse 13. Verse 13, if we left 12 alone, we're kind of on So ice that begins to crack, but Paul freezes it to safe depths in verse 13 when he says, "For it is God who works in you, both to will," don't lose these, this isn't just superfluous writing here, "both to will and to work for his good pleasure." Where do I get the energy to work out my own salvation? Don't look in yourself. Trust in, rely on God. Because it is God who is working in you. And do you see where he's working in you? At what level? To make you, to allow you, to call you to will. To want, to desire, to do God's will. He works at the inward desires of our hearts. Not mere behavior modification. This isn't how I usually fail as a parent, just wanting them to obey, change your behaviors, but inside their hearts are still like, why do I have to do that? Because you're part of a family. Obey. Clean your room. Empty the dishwasher. Right, Kathy? This isn't mere behavior modification. This is heart transformation. This is causing you to desire more of the things of God and to put away the world. This is being transformed instead of being conformed, being transformed by the word of Christ. I love that. It's not just merely giving you a jolt of energy, a dose of caffeine, a hot shot of coffee to get you through your day. It's to work to make you will, to make your desires change, to then work for his good pleasures. Love that. It's God who is changing your will to love others more deeply. To think about family promise and get a little choked up. To give to others sacrificially, as I have seen this body do many times. And amazingly giving in sacrificial ways. I've been the recipient of it. I've witnessed you guys all doing it so often. To look to others' interests, not only to your own. God is actively in the person and work of God the Holy Spirit, working in you to change your desires to be more like Christ's, who took on the form of a servant. It's right there in 13, and it is so powerful. I think of the cell design in seventh grade. My life science teacher told us, and it was a memory device, and it helped you remember that the mitochondria is the power source of the cell. So quick science recap, and he was like, it's the mitochondria! And that stuck in my head. Verse 13 is the mitochondria for a Christian's work. That's how we work out our salvation, because it's God who is working in us both to will and to work for his good pleasure. And friends, this is transformative. This changes our thinkings as we go to Bible study. Well, I better read a Bible because it's good for me. Yeah, it is, but you're going to the source of how your heart is being transformed. You're going to the image that you are seeking to be more like in your own life. To our young people who are bombarded in every front with competing messages that tend to butt their heads against biblical teachings, come here to see that it is God who works in you both to will and to work for his good pleasure. You're going to be told that genders are fluid and that sexuality has no constraints. But find your will in the will of God, because it is him who will change you. You're going to be told that you can have fame and fortune, and that's what you seek in this life. Brock, you can be famous. That's what's important in this life. No, you can seek to do the will of God and do that for his good pleasures, to be more like Christ. You can be told a myriad of lies by culture, but if you were straying in any way from being more like Christ, we want to see and comply with God's word to follow him and to follow him more faithfully, using God's power. Because it is God who is working in you to change you and to change your will, your desires, to do what pleases him. And we haven't talked about it yet, but how is that accomplished? How does Paul tell us to approach that? Flippantly? Just haphazardly? I'll go to a Bible verse and I'll read it and I'll just get some mystical source of energy. No, he says with fear and trembling. Because this is serious business. Because we want to be more like Christ. Even when it's, especially when it's hard. Especially when you're being pinched by society, or you're being pressured by even family in ways that pull you away from Christ. With fear and trembling, consider the costs, consider what's at stake, and take up your cross and follow Christ daily. It doesn't say take up your pillow and your hazmat suit. No, take up your cross and follow Christ daily. Die to self. Put away your desires and your motives if they're out of alignment with God's will, and seek His, to do His will in fear and trembling, to do work for His good pleasure. And it will cost you. Obedience is costly at times. Jesus goes so far as to say that it's going to cost relationships between fathers and sons, mothers and daughters. It can go to that level. It can cost you jobs. It can cost you friendships and relationships. But following closely after Christ, what it will cost you is a paltry sum in comparison to what you gain in the exaltation of Jesus Christ and being welcomed into His glorious kingdom. Paul, just one chapter later, says in verses 13 through 16, lest you think that there's any sense of perfectionism here, brothers, I do not consider that I have made it my own. Talking about he's not perfect in verse 12. I haven't made perfection my own, but one thing I do, forgetting what lies behind, his life as a Pharisee, his life of trying to earn salvation by following the law, I forget what lies behind and I strain forward to what lies ahead. I press on, fear of trembling, anybody? I press on toward the goal of the prize of the upward call of God in Christ Jesus. Let those of us who are mature think this way, and if anything you think otherwise, God will reveal that to you in your thinking, in your will, because He wants you to desire and to will what pleases Him. So let us hold fast to any ground in godliness we gain, especially because we know it's coming from the power of God. And may we press on, may we strive forward, forgetting what lies behind with fear and trembling, and seek greater and greater obedience to God and to do what pleases Him. And let us never lose sight of the fact that this is grace. Work out, but it's grace because it's God who is working in us. It's God bestowing on us the riches that Christ has earned via the cross and His obedience. The one who had everything and who lacked nothing became nothing so that we would one day have everything with Him in glory. And that, dear friends, is so far from legalism. It's smack dab in the middle of grace because it is God who is working in you. Love that. So we get to become more and more like Jesus Christ with great fear and trembling, and it's never for our own purposes. It's for God's. And just like Jesus, our sanctification is not self-serving. He, in His perfect obedience, was doing so as a servant, and it's always to point to the one who saved us. And it is also then serving as a light to those who are perishing in this wicked, wretched, and sin-wracked world. And that's the point of verses 14 through 18. So after all that build-up in chapter 2, verses 1 through 11, building up, giving us the example of Christ, and then making this call of, in reality, perseverance in the power of God, given to us in the power of God to both will and to work for His good pleasure, it's in that that He says, do all things without grumbling or disputing. I can serve others, even sacrificially, and then grumble about it. I could have done such and such with that item, or whatever the case may be. Do all things without grumbling or disputing, that you may be blameless and innocent. Uh-oh, perfectionism? No. Children of God without blemish in the midst of a crooked and twisted generation, among whom you shine as lights in the world. That was the purpose for having Tom read from the Sermon on the Mount. After talking about salt, he says we are to be lights, not underneath a basket, or not in the walls of the church only, but in our everyday lives, holding fast, verse 16, holding fast to the word of life. Oh, the word of life, the word gives life. Holding fast to the word of life so that in the day of Christ I may be proud, Paul says of this Philippian church, that I did not run in vain or labor in vain, working again. Verse 17, even if I am to be poured out as a drink offering upon the sacrificial offering of your faith, Philippian church, I am glad and rejoice with you all. Likewise, you also should be glad and rejoice with me. Paul starts out in verse 14 to tell us to do all things well so that we may be blameless. Now, we know we'll never be perfect in this iteration of life and before Christ comes back. In fact, John told us in 1 John that if we say we do not have sin, we deceive ourselves and the truth is not in us. So with sinless perfection off the table, what does Paul mean here? So that you may be blameless. And I found this from Dr. James Boyce to be helpful. He said, this does not mean that there will ever come a time in our lives when we shall be without sin. Real sanctification, being made more holy, being made more like Christ, that's what that word sanctification ultimately kind of simply means. Real sanctification, real Christ-likeness maybe, lies in the increasing realization of how sinful we are. It means that our lives will be lived in the sight of God in such a way that they will be open before Him. There will be no barriers between ourselves and God. And if we live this way, we shall be able to pray as David prayed in Psalm 139, search me, O God, and know my heart, or the source of my will. Know my heart and test me and know my anxious thoughts. See if there is any offensive way in me and lead me in the way everlasting. Close quote. So we know that ultimately we will be seen as blameless because of Christ's work on our behalf, but in reality we still walk with two natures and fighting against the one and seeking to feed the other. In our growth and holiness, our fight and our war against sin is done with fear and trembling so that we can be a light in the world which is comprised of wicked and crookedness in all forms. A light in darkness. And knowing that would be a test all its own, Paul tethers us to the word of life, God's glorious revelation to us. He doesn't say lean on and rely on dreams or to speculations or even feelings and emotions, as sometimes right as they are, but they're not always. Lean on, be linked to, cling to the word of life. And our obedience then is a testimony to and a reason for rejoicing for those who pay into your life. Love that. Paul looked to the obedience of this Philippian church as a reason to rejoice. And what he'd done?
No.
What they had done? No. But what God had done in them. And he's okay with the fact that he may never see them again. He may die for them. Because remember, for Paul, to live is Christ, to die is gain. But the picture Paul paints here as we get close to our end, this verse 17, he says, even if I'm to be poured out as a drink offering upon the sacrificial offering of your faith, I am glad and rejoice with you all. That is a deep picture for his original audience. They would have known very well the pagan altars that really saturated all of the Roman Empire. In Rome and in cities that were Roman and pagan temples, they would offer a beast of some form, cow, bull, ram, on a hot, scalding, fire-fueled altar. And as the sacrificial animal was being reduced to ashes, they would pour a drink offering on top of it, and it would immediately turn into vapor. They were offering to some pagan god, and this huge sacrifice, and they would take some libation, pour it on it, and it would be reduced to vapor. And Paul is saying, even if I die at the hands of pagan Rome in my imprisonment, I know my life is but a vapor on the altar of the greater sacrifice of a life devoted to Jesus Christ, or a church devoted to Jesus Christ. He says, I know I'm not dying in vain. Even if I die at the hands of pagan Rome, your faithfulness, your obedience to Christ makes his work in them an offering to God in reality. And in that, we see a beautiful picture of mutual rejoicing. They can rejoice and be glad with Paul, that he is rejoicing and be glad with their obedience, and it causes all of them to rejoice. Obedience shouldn't lead us to begrudgingness and to drudgery. Obedience can cause us to rejoice and to rejoice with each other. And in that teacher class or missionary mission field or shepherd flock, there is mutual rejoicing. And the life of a church following closely after Jesus Christ should give ample cause for rejoicing in Jesus Christ. So may we all, as individual members of the body of Christ and as a corporate body of Christ here as Delton Community Church or where you all maybe worship other Sundays, may we rejoice in victory over sin. May we rejoice over a victory over addiction. As you and I, with fear and trembling, bring about Christ-likeness in our individual lives, all in the power of God who wills and works in us to work towards what pleases Him. May we all rejoice in greater faithfulness to spouses, to friends, to employers, to children, to nieces and nephews, to friends, to schools, as we with fear and trembling bring out Christ-likeness in our lives, all in the power of God who works to will us to want to do these things that please Him. May we rejoice in battling against depression and anxiety and self-doubt and even suicidal thoughts as we, as the body of Christ, with fear and trembling, seek to honor Him and to seek to will what He wills as He works in us. And may we be a light to fellow weary travelers of this wicked and crooked world so that they see the hope we have in the finished work of Jesus Christ. Nothing else is needed for your salvation, to be sure. God didn't do 80% and is waiting for you to fulfill the 20. Jesus paid it all. All to Him I owe. My sin had left a crimson stain and He washed it white as snow. Nothing in my hands I bring, simply to Thy cross I cling. Jesus paid it all, and we rest in that finished work, and we desire to do what pleases God in that finished work, knowing that we're merely cooperating with the life of Christ and trying to be more like Him, to cause each other to rejoice and to be shining lights to this world around us that is increasingly darker and darker. So may we be emboldened to look at the train tracks of life and see the perfect straightness of God's track and try to line our track up right next to it. Parallel unison so that we ride together with Him in the power of the Holy Spirit to be more like Christ as He does His work in us to will for His great pleasures, for His glory and His glory alone. Let's pray. Gracious God, we thank You for Paul's unflinching honesty as he tells us to work out to produce fruits of obedience, God. And we are so thankful for verse 13 that tells us it is You who ultimately does that work in us to not only cause us to work rightly, but Father, to desire rightly as we seek every day to be more like Jesus Christ, every day to be more like Him. And in that, Father, we stand in Your grace. God, may we strive against a mindset of legalism in our own minds, and may we focus on ourselves all the more to be more like Jesus Christ, knowing that as we do that, we're adding to the cause and the reason to rejoice in the body of Christ. And Father, may we be a church that unflinchingly shares the truth, but stands in Your grace, speaks the truth in love, and welcomes sinners in this everyday battle of trying to be more like Christ. Welcomes them to be one of us because that's what we are too. Polished up and looking good on Sunday, but Father, with hearts that are in battle to want to be more like Christ. May we engage with that lifestyle and may it be a light to this world around us, to the Delta community, to our families and our workplaces, in our friendships, in our schools. God, may we honor You and seek Your glory above all. It's in Christ's powerful name that we pray. Amen.